help us tonight. He will supply all the grace. The Bible says that he's able to cause all grace. That means there are different kinds of grace. Hallelujah. Different kinds. For the Bible to say that God is able to cause all grace to abound towards us. And that includes grace for everything you can ever conceive of. Everything that is good and godly, according to his will. So he will help us tonight in every way in which we need help. In the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We send a big welcome to those who are joining us on live stream. God bless you. We're trusting God tonight that it will be another session of enlightenment by the Spirit of God tonight. Apostle Paul prayed in the book of Ephesians chapter 1, pray that the eyes of our understanding may be enlightened. For us to walk in the fullness of the will of God, we need this enlightenment. Our desire and prayer to God tonight is that we will have it.
Amen.
In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Glory to God forevermore.
Hallelujah.
We recently finished studying the book of Romans. And you agree with me that what God dealt to us from that book, the volume of it, the depth of it, most especially things that we thought that we knew before, can only be described as humbling. Hallelujah. There is a depth of the word of God that we cannot get to on this side of eternity. But the good thing about it is this: the more we know, the more we understand, the more we are transformed into his image. I trust God that as we enter into this book, the book of Colossians, we will have a deeper experience than we had when we studied Romans, in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, remember when we studied the book of Romans, we discovered that Apostle Paul, as at the time he wrote the epistle, had not been to Rome before. He had not been part of those churches physically. He did express his desire at that time to come over to Rome to visit with them. Specifically, he said he wanted to come and impart on them spiritual blessings. He desired that God would bless them through his ministry. Eventually, Apostle Paul went to Rome. But not exactly the way he thought he was going to go. For he left on a journey first to Jerusalem to minister to the church at Jerusalem. He had things to give them that had been contributions from another church. When he got to Jerusalem, Apostle Paul was dealt a very heavy and bad hand by the Jews, his fellow former compatriots, people who are into Judaism. For the gospel that the Apostle Paul preached at that time, they rallied the government to get him arrested. And they sought to pass on him the death penalty, to kill him. But as God will have it, while he was still under arrest in Jerusalem, the people who were against him, they couldn't wait for justice from government. So they planned by themselves that will kill him. In fact, a great number of them, a good company of them, they bound themselves with an oath that they would not eat until they killed Apostle Paul. I'm not sure what happened to those guys at the end of the day, whether they died of hunger or they had to break their vow eventually, because it's on record that they didn't get to kill him. Word came to him that this was the plan they had for him, and they notified governor, who transferred him from Jerusalem to Caesarea. He was in Caesarea for 2 years. 2 years in prison. Right? They were just dilly-dallying with the Apostle Paul. Invariably, when he realized that there was no way he was going to get judgment or freedom from the authorities there, he appealed to be sent to Caesar in Rome. And off to Rome, Apostle Paul, when they bundled him, we know the story, how they had that famous shipwreck on the way. Eventually, through thick and thin, through water and storm, through every other thing you can conceive of, in terms of danger. He was bitten by a poisonous snake along the line. But Apostle Paul got to Rome. The desire of his heart was fulfilled. However, not how he planned. He got to Rome eventually as a prisoner. We have it on record that Apostle Paul continued in Rome for 2 years, in prison still. But thank God, God gave him favor with the authorities. They didn't put him in the common jail. He was under what we describe today as house arrest. They allowed him to rent an apartment and they locked him down there with guards looking after him, watching out for him. He didn't go anywhere. He had to stay put, even though they allowed people who came to see him to see him. And you know the fascinating part of it? Apostle Paul continued his ministry even when he was imprisoned. That led to that hallelujah, that very popular saying in scripture that the word of God is not bound. I may be in chain or in chains, but the word of God is not in chains. He ministered from the prison. Glory to God. And somewhere, somewhat, I don't want to say coincidentally, because we know that with God there is no coincidence, Apostle Paul wrote 4 epistles from the prison he was in at Rome. And the one of the epistles we are looking at tonight, the book of Colossians, was written while Apostle Paul was in prison in Rome. And this is how he went. There was this minister. His name was Epaphras. Epaphras is believed by Bible historians to have been the pastor or the head of the church at Colossae at that time. Epaphras happened to be Apostle Paul's convert. He was converted under Apostle Paul's ministry while Apostle Paul ministered at Ephesus. So he heard that Apostle Paul was in jail in Rome, and he came not just to visit him, he came to minister to Apostle Paul in prison. Minister as in to serve him, to help him. So when he came, he brought good news about the church at Colossae. Just like we had in the case of the churches at Rome, Apostle Paul, as at the time he wrote this epistle, had not been to Colossae to fellowship with the believers there. He did not establish the church. The church was established by one of his converts, Epaphras. So Epaphras brought good news to Apostle Paul. Now see what the Lord is doing in the midst of us, in the church. People are growing spiritually, learning the word of God. And we'll see Apostle Paul giving thanks for the good news that he brought. But he didn't stop there. He also brought word to Apostle Paul that certain heretic teachers have managed to infiltrate the church, teaching wrong doctrine at that time. It was in response to this that Apostle Paul wrote this epistle that we are going to be studying right now, and sent it to the church there, so that by it he would, of course, introduce himself as usual, and then set them straight in terms of doctrine to eliminate the heresy that the devil was trying to smuggle into the church at that time. That is by way of background, so we know how this book we're studying today came to be. So we go straight into it. Colossians, the first chapter. I'm going to take the first 2 verses and we'll continue from there. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ by the will of God, and Timotheus, our brother, to the saints and the faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae, grace be unto you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. We see the normal opening by Apostle Paul in his letters, almost all of them. He introduced himself. They've not met him before. Probably they've heard of him. But this will be the first formal contact that the apostle had with them. And you wonder why the Apostle Paul always started his writings, his letters, almost all of them, like this. I believe he did it so that the letter will carry the necessary weight for people to pay attention to what was in it. Hallelujah. Saying, my name is Paul. I'm an ordained minister of God, sent by him as an apostle to the body of Christ. That enough for any discerning believer to catch their attention. Now, this is not just a letter from a friend or a letter from a suitor. This is God speaking to me through the ministry of the Apostle Paul. Hallelujah. Amen. And you see in the second verse, it says, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ, which are at Colossae. He wrote these from the heart of God to the saints. And to the extent that we, members of the body of Christ, we've talked about this before, I believe when we were studying the book of Romans, are saints, we will be very correct, 100%, to say this also was written to us. Was written to us. Everything in this book that we're going to review and study together were written to us. What Apostle Paul said in that opening verse is very important. The weight of what he wrote down and sent to these people are written to us from 2 Corinthians chapter 12 and the 12th verse. Here the Apostle Paul is doing something similar. He said, truly, the signs of an apostle were wrought among you in all patience, in signs and wonders and mighty deeds. There was need for Apostle Paul to emphasize this because he had been to the Corinthians before. And he said to them, take heed to what I'm saying. These are not the words of man, but the words of God. Be convinced, if for no other reason, for what you saw God demonstrate through me and my ministry. The signs of the apostle, the things that God did through him in words and in deeds. It will amaze us to learn that the mighty deeds that the Apostle Paul did at that time, of which he was so confident, of which he reminded the people that, look at the seal of God on my ministry and take heed to my doctrine because of that. Because I'm giving you what God is saying. Those mighty deeds, none of them had to do with the completion of construction projects. Are you with me? None of them had to do with the procurement of state-of-the-art chariots to prove that the seal of God was on his ministry. That wasn't what he had as an apostle sent of God. What he had was what he referred to as the people whose lives were transformed by God through him. He called them his epistles. That means God wrote the transformation of their lives. He referred to that as God's writing for all to see. The proof of God's ordination upon his life. We'll do well to learn from that. Hallelujah. We'll do very well to learn from that. The transformed lives of believers is the proof of God's call on the life of a minister. As we see the Apostle Paul make clear here. So we'll do well also to take heed to these things that we'll be studying in the book of Colossians. We'll continue from verse 3 through to 7. Who's going to help us with that? Verses 3 through to 7, Colossians chapter 1.
We give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying always for you. Since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have all the saints, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, wherefore ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel, which is come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit as it doeth also in you, since the day ye heard of it, and knew the grace of God in truth. As ye are learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow steward, our fellow servant, who is for you in faithful minister of Christ.
Thank you so much, my brother. God bless you. The first thing the Apostle Paul said here is that himself and those who were with him at that time, since the time they heard of the believers at Colossae, they did not stop to pray for them. See the word prayer again. He said they prayed always for them after hearing of what God was doing in their lives. Emphasis on prayer. In fact, there's something we learn from this, that prayer for other saints is a Christian tradition that the church ought to observe for all times. Remember Ephesians chapter 6. Let's turn there together. Just two books before Colossians. Ephesians 6 in verse 18. This is Apostle Paul writing to the church at Ephesus at that time, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Don't forget that it was in this chapter that the Apostle Paul started out from, I think, around the 10th verse, saying, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, encouraging the believers to do all that is necessary for them to remain strong spiritually. And when he was going to end it all, look at what he said. It appears to me from here as though the reason why the Apostle Paul, one of the reasons, desired and encouraged and admonished the believers to be strong is so that they'll be able to pray one for another. Does it not appear to you like that? He said, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. Put on the whole armor so that you'll be able to stand against all the wiles of the devil. After he finished that discussion, he rounded it up by saying, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Not even for themselves at this time. For all saints. Praying for the saints is a Christian tradition that the church ought to maintain for all times. In fact, when I saw this, I told myself, we will have to include this formally in the things we pray for on Mondays. Specifically, praying for the saints, both here and all over. Of course, it's not as though we have not been praying. We have been, but specifically, it is necessary. Because it just occurred to me, the Bible says that where there is envy and strife, there is confusion and every evil work. That's one fundamental thing that the devil uses to scatter believers. But is it possible for you to be envious of the person you are praying for? Is it possible for you to think evil towards the person you are praying for every day? It's going to be difficult. It's a tradition we must wake up to. As a church, as the church globally, praying one for another. I want to encourage us, please, make it a habit to pray for believers you know every day. Let not one day pass without you praying for believers that you know. Let not one day pass without you praying for unbelievers that you know so that they may be saved. These things will not happen without these prayers going up to God. For God to move, somebody's got to pray. Apostle Paul here laying a very good example. And let's look at the details of what they prayed to God about the believers at Colossae. About three, if you look through that prayer up until verse all the way down to, in fact, verse 22. It seems as though the prayer was was divided into three parts. I'm going to take them part by part tonight, so that we can get the most understanding out of what the Apostle Paul is saying. First and foremost, he said, we prayed for you always. What about number one, thanksgiving? In verse 3, we give thanks to God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, praying for you always. Praying always for you. They started out by giving thanks to God. Let's look at what they were giving thanks to God for. Verse 4. It says, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which ye have to all saints. They heard of their faith in Christ Jesus and the love they had for the saints and gave thanks to God for this. They gave thanks for more, but let's start with these two. Faith and their love. Someone please help me. If you go somewhere and you come back with a report that, oh, the people were joyful. Why? How would you have known that the people in that place you went to were joyful? Let me tell you why I'm asking this. They brought reports to Apostle Paul. He had never been to Colossae. He had not seen the people before. They brought report to him about their faith and their love. Now, the person who brought the report, how did he know about their faith in Christ and their love? Someone please help me.
Their action.
Do we agree? Who disagrees? We all agree. Their action. Their faith in Christ. The faith in Christ he's talking about here is not the faith to receive from God, essentially. No, he's talking about their Christian faith. Talking about the fact that they were believers in Christ. One thing is clear here. The proof of our belief in Christ is in what we do. How we live. So the report they brought to him was, these people, they are taking their Christian life seriously. How come? The fellow who brought the report saw it. Similarly, their love for one another. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Believe me, if we take our Christian life seriously, it cannot be hidden. The same way, if we love other believers, we can't hide it also. It must be seen. The Apostle Paul did not give thanks to God for this only. Look at verse 5 with me, please. It says, for the hope which is laid up for you in heaven, whereof ye heard before in the word of the truth of the gospel. Verse 6, which is come unto you as it is in all the world, and bringeth forth fruit, as it doth also in you since the day ye heard it and knew the grace of God in truth. He gave thanks to God for the hope that these believers at Colossae had. You know, Apostle Paul said that what you have seen, you don't hope for anymore. Why? Why don't we hope for what we have seen already? Because we have it already. So what the Apostle Paul is talking about here is what the believers there did not have at that time. And he made it clear the direction in which it was going. He said the hope they had were laid up for them in their hometown, in heaven. Hallelujah. How could somebody know that these people have such a hope? Let's do some mental work tonight. How do I know that this individual has hope for something waiting for them in heaven? How would I know? Don't forget, the Apostle Paul is responding to reports that he was given, not revelation now. Somebody told him. So the person that told him, how did that person know that these people had hope laid for them in heaven? Someone please help us. The truth of the gospel. True. What it means is that the hope they have was brought to them by the gospel which they heard. Not only they alone, said all around the world, other believers too. Alright? They heard the same gospel. But the question is, how do you know somebody has hope leading heaven? Thank you. Does anybody disagree that from somebody's lifestyle you can know whether the person has hope laid up in heaven or not? Do we agree? So we'll move on. From their lifestyle. There is something critical we should put on top of our to-do. It's going to help us a lot. We should always do the things or do things that prove to us that we believe that there is a hell to shun and a heaven to gain. Are we together? There is a hell to shun and there is a heaven to gain. In other words, the Christ in whom I've come to believe that is making me live the way I am living, it has something I'm going to gain from it. Not here. Not so that when I want to buy top of the art vehicle, I can believe God for it. No, it has nothing to do with here. Hope in heaven. There is a heaven to gain and a hell to shun. If we put that on top of our list, there is no way we will not be guided by the word of God. In fact, that will be the beginning of humility. If we do that, there is a God I answer to, who I'm going to stand face to face with one day on the other side of eternity. That is what would dictate, that is what should dictate how we go about life down here. I believe Epaphras that gave this report to Apostle Paul saw in the believers at Colossae the enthusiasm they had about the gospel. It wasn't just one of those things. No, it wasn't. They did something or many things actively about it. It dictated how they lived. It set their priorities. And then Apostle Paul went on to say in the 7th verse, as he also learned of Epaphras, our dear fellow servant, who is for you a faithful minister of Christ. This is the verse that made historians believe that Epaphras was the leader or pastor of the church at Colossae. In the Bible, that is. Of course, there are other history books that prove that he was a minister at that location. In the 6th verse, go back just one verse, we see here that the Apostle Paul said, proving what we just discussed, that the way the hope that he had was known was the fruit. Glory to God. Fruit that was shown forth in their life. The fruit of faith in Christ. The truth of the whole matter is this. I mean, I'm sure you know, we all know this. If we believe in Christ, we are different. Otherwise, Jesus would not have said, if any man be in Christ is a new creature, all things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. We are different. There is a huge, huge difference. That difference can only be compared with the difference between where Lazarus was after he died and where the rich man was. I don't know how different that is to you. Think about it. How different is it? Where Lazarus was and where the rich man was, how different do we think it is? Very different. The thought of that alone will give us passion to do all we know to do for those who have not come to receive the gift of eternal life that Jesus Christ came to give freely, that they may receive it. If it is to pray, if it is to constantly be in their faces telling them what the Bible says until they receive it, so they can make it to where you are going also. Glory to God forevermore. Amen. So much in this opening seven verses. They look so ordinary. When I was studying, in my mind, I said to myself, no wonder. Even Peter had to give testimony about the writings of Paul. That if you are unlearned, if you don't settle down and follow them very well, they will be hard for you to understand. Hallelujah. So much in just these seven verses, seven opening verses of this book of Colossians for us to learn from. I believe that we have picked up one or two things. And we'll go ahead and look at the second part of his prayer. The first part was giving thanks. It was thanking God for such a transformation that had happened in the lives of the believers at Colossae. And he went ahead and described it. And he didn't mince words. He said, the reason why this transformation took place in you is because of how you took the gospel that was preached to you and how you are still taking it up until that time. When we believe the gospel the way we ought to believe it, we will be different. That's just it. That's the truth. Let's take comments and questions, if you have any, before we look at the second part of the prayer of Apostle Paul. The prayer of Apostle Paul and those who were with him. Because in verse 2 he said, we give thanks. If nothing else, Timothy was with him also at that time. So at least we will know two people. Sorry, one or two people, Timothy and then Epaphras, were with him at that time. Reverend.
Yeah, we should make mention of the latter part of verse 6 also. About the grace of God.
I knew the grace of God in truth. Connecting it to all that the Apostle Paul has said, at least most especially in the previous verse and this sixth one. The proof of knowing the grace of God in truth is shown forth in the fruit that is produced. Let me put it in very plain language, because you know we always like to placate people's in plain English, right? Apostle Paul is saying we could see the sign in you that you are thoughtful of where you are going after you die, and that is reflecting how you are living your lives. That's the summary of what the Apostle Paul is saying here. We cannot remove it from Scripture. That's exactly what he was saying. If we say we have the grace of God, which we have if we are born again, if we are handling it right, it will make a difference. That difference was what Epaphras came to tell the Apostle Paul. That can you imagine? And you know, Colossae, according to history, was a city that was given to idolatry. Their main object of worship, guess what it was? You will laugh. Mm-hmm. In Jamaica. Yeah. So for people who had lived their lives ever since they were born, they learned that, they lived that, for them to be so transformed, to have this kind of testimony that Epaphras gave concerning them, that is in no way a small or little transformation. They were totally transformed. It was clear that these people that I can see, the only reason why they can be living this way is because of the hope that they have laid up in heaven. They were mindful of that reward. The reward of what? The reward of believing Christ. We always think about it as free gift. We never see the other side. But it's actually a reward. Reward that goes to people who believe. If you don't believe, you won't have it. If you believe, you will have it. So in that sense, it's a reward. Not for anything you have done in your own power, but for what? For believing. Because it's possible for you not to believe. Of course, a lot of people don't. But our desire and prayer is that many will believe. Hallelujah. And knew the grace of God in truth. That means you've come to understand what God means by his grace. Apostle Paul said in one place, he said, receive not the grace of God in vain. Grace of God is received in vain when it is not allowed to do what it's supposed to do. We know all these things already. Glory to God. But it's good for us to remind ourselves that in the midst of all the idolatry at Colossae, there were people at this time who lived as though they were heaven bound. Apostle Paul was thanking God for that, praying for them. So what, Rev, you still want to say something?
Well, I just want to emphasize the issue of the grace also for the benefit of those people that are listening on the stream to understand and differentiate between the way the Bible explains what the grace of God is to the way people tend to try to explain what the grace of God is right now. And the grace of God in Colossae showed in the life of the people by making them to do the right thing. Like they brought the fruits of the word of God out of their life. Not only was their life fruitful, they were bearing fruit also. And then they were living as somebody that have a hope in heaven. So they were not living carelessly, saying that, well, I mean, we've been saved. It's all grace. We can live anyhow. That is not their story. So really, if truly we understand the grace of God, we won't be living carelessly and doing anything and justifying it with the fact that it's covered by grace. Praise God.
Thank you, Reverend. Two things, just to support that even the more before we move ahead, that the Apostle Paul did mention in particular. He mentioned their faith in Christ, and he mentioned their love for the saints. So we understand what Reverend was saying about being careful in what we do. Let's take a practical example. The Apostle Paul mentioned love here for the brethren. Now, if you love the brethren, will you strive with them? Let me not use the Bible word. Let me use the one that we understand very well. Will you fight with your fellow believer if you love them? So we can conclude that the believers at Colossae were not fighting themselves. Why will you fight somebody? Go check it out. The first answer that will come to mind is, the person offended me. No, it's not the offense per se. You're envious. You feel because the person did something, that person has preeminence over you. Meanwhile, you are the one that you have preeminence. So you now fight to show they don't. Forget it. Envy is somewhere around the corner. The believers at Colossae did something in the positive before somebody would testify to say their love, if you see their love. And if indeed they were walking in love, we won't find envy and strife there. Now, we would be right to say that if we choose to live our lives in love towards the brethren, because of God, we are living as people who have hope in heaven. Now, if we, as believers, born again, we live in strife, will we still be correct to say we are living like people who have hope in heaven? No. The answer is no. That is the difference. Grace does not mean just continue living in strife. Don't worry, grace covers it. That's not the reason why God gave the grace. God gave the grace to produce fruit. And that fruit is in obedience. Do not strive, walk in love. That's just an example. It covers practically every other thing that has to do with human beings. Hallelujah.
Amen.
My prayer is that for all of us, somebody will be able to know whether we like it, we have to be doing it habitually. I thank God for Bro Sean. I'm so happy. Well, it's nice thing to call like that. Because it's just guy. It's just, Father, thank you for that man. Look at how he's so helpful, so gracious. May that be what we'll be doing one towards another.
Amen.
That is how it ought to be in the body of Christ. Look at Apostle Paul. What he wanted to do was to pray. He first of all had to give thanks for how much the word of God is working. They are lying to work in them at Colossae at that time. Faith and their love one for another. Very important. Let's go to part B. I believe we've talked about everything there is. No, well, it can't be everything there is to talk about. Hallelujah. The much we can talk about verses 1 through to 7 tonight. Let's take from 8 to 11. And this is where I want us to pay attention. Now, what we've studied so far, I'm not sure that's how the whole of the remaining part of the book is, but what we've studied so far seem to be packaged in such a way that the things are hidden inside, so we have to draw them out. Now, if you don't pay attention, we won't get it. Amen? Anybody reads that verses 3 through to 7, you just ask yourself, what is it? What exactly is he saying? This is like, the only thing I understand is I give thanks. But see, if you take time and carefully look through it, comparing scripture with scripture, we'll be able to pull out what was behind Apostle Paul praying the prayer, giving thanks for those things, in particular about the believers at Colossae. So I want us to pay additional attention as we look at verses 8 through to 11. There is so much in these four verses, so much. Let's help one another get the understanding tonight. Who's going to help us with those four verses?
Who also the 8 to
11. You're right.
Okay. Who also declared unto us your love in spirit? For this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. 10. That ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long sufferings with joyfulness.
Thank you. See those four verses. What do they sound like in your ears? Just pass and go ahead. I mean, we was praying for them. And you feel with the knowledge of God's will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding, and that they may walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work and increasing knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness. Let's tear it apart one by one, starting from verse 8. You know, we said earlier on that Epaphras brought news to Apostle Paul, right? That is confirmed by verse 8. Everything the Apostle Paul knew about the believers at Colossae was a result of what Epaphras told him. And he knew that Epaphras was dependable because Epaphras was his convert at Ephesus. So you know, this is not just stories. You know, he believed the report that was given to him, just as we said earlier. Now, after giving thanks, part two of the prayer, for this cause, since the day we heard of all these things I had to say concerning you, we have not stopped to pray for you and desire that you may be filled with the knowledge of the will of God in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Up until now, I thought, which is right anyway, by itself, that here Apostle Paul was talking about you knowing more about the Word of God. That is right. Filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. Are we together? Yes, we should increase in the knowledge of God. He still mentioned it in two verses later. Okay? But I did as usual. I went into etymology. Let's look at these words. What exactly do they mean? And invariably, I found out that what drove Apostle Paul's prayer was this: that God, I want your will, are we together, to become reality in the lives of these people. Do you get that? The knowledge here is not knowledge of, I heard you are in town. That's knowledge, right? That is different from, my God, how you doing? Fellowship. The person being in town is your reality. It's not on the phone. You can see the person like this. You can hug the person. That is the form of knowledge he's talking about here. The will of God be you knowing by experience. In other words, if God's will is for believers to walk in love, he's saying, God, let walking in love become them. Do you understand what I'm saying? Let it become reality in their lives. This is a very powerful prayer. In fact, every shepherd should be praying it for their sheep. Because that's the ultimate of a New Testament is transformation in the life of the believer for God's will to become reality in their lives. If it's how God wants you to walk, that is how you are walking. Of course, it comes through understanding God's word. It comes through the knowledge of the word of God. Faith in the word of God produces these results. But the ultimate is that the word of God, his will become reality in the believers' lives. Does it sound any different from Romans chapter 8? Where he says, for those he foreknew, then he also predestinated to be conformed to the image of Christ. Do they sound similar? Help me. They sound similar. Talking about the same thing. The more conformed to the image of Christ we are, the more the will of God becomes a reality. Now, let's do an exercise. You really have to help me here. You know, it's easy to say, oh, the will of God become reality in your life. What is the will of God? A quick one would be to say the will of God is the word of God. But how does that apply to our day-to-day lives? So let's try and reduce it. Someone give us an example of what the will of God is. What you know is the will. Yes, the will of God is the word of God, no doubt. What is the will of God for the believer? Reverend, please.
To be like Christ.
To be like Christ.
Conformed to the image of Jesus Christ.
To be conformed to the image of Jesus Christ.
To want what he wants.
To want what he wants.
To will what he will.
To will what he wills.
To be in agreement with him.
To be in agreement with him. At all times. Hallelujah. Isn't that powerful? Very true. But let's still break it down before that. Something we can apply to our lives. Now, okay. If I know this thing, I can wake up tomorrow and say, I want to do the will of God as per what I learned today. That's what I mean. I can do it like taking hot chocolate if I want to. Just one example. Or two. Come on, help me out. Let me to learn something now. Hallelujah.
Okay, you mean like give an example like praying.
Oh yeah. Okay. She mentioned praying. Praying is the will of God. Walking in love is the will of God.
Okay. Faith.
Living by faith is the will of God. I mean, we don't have any issue with that because we know they are scriptural. All of them are scriptural. Any other example?
Studying the word.
Studying the Bible. Meditate on these things. Give yourself wholly unto them. Apostle Paul is saying, God, let this thing become their reality. In other words, let them get to the point at which they are consistently studying the word of God, meditating on it, giving themselves wholly to it, until fruits of those things they are studying begin to show in their lives. just by way of example. I must say this tonight. Please, I want us to watch out for ourselves, our own personal benefit and good. The things we hear in church, they should affect how we live. If they don't, we are missing out. You know, we're in church thrice a week. Yeah, faithfully. Not for any other thing, but because we enjoy the fellowship one with another. That's one. Two, it's an opportunity for God to impart things on us. And one major way by which he does that is through the teaching and preaching of his word. The prophecies that come out, the words of knowledge, the words of wisdom in particular. And any other way the Holy Spirit chooses to manifest himself when we come together. Very key. They must be impacting our daily lives. That is how transformation will come. So if we come to church and the things we're hearing is not impacting, the devil is stealing from us. So we should watch it and repair that area. The bad part of it is this. For us, if we allow the devil to steal from us, what we get in church, we cannot get outside the church. And I will explain what I mean. Remember Jesus Christ talking about the Holy Spirit with the disciples. He called him the Spirit of Truth. And he said something. He said, whom the world not may not, cannot receive. Why? They don't know him. Now, if the Holy Spirit is the one that teaches us the wisdom of God, how on earth can you assume and still remain intelligent that you can get that wisdom in the world? What do you think about it? It doesn't just make any spiritual sense. That's the reason why it becomes very saddening when what is being offered in church, for whatever reason, is not what the Holy Spirit is offering. It's a problem. It's like double jeopardy. Are we together? Bottom line is, the things we learn, the things we hear in church, should impact our day-to-day lives. If it's not happening, you have the right to say, Pastor, come. I've been hearing you for 1 year. Nothing is impacting. That means you are not preaching the right thing. Take it on with Pastor. Yes. Pastor says, what do you mean? Say, well, Pastor Boy said so. Take it on with me also. Hallelujah. I won't tell you I'm laughing. But please, I just said that as a joke. But seriously, it is your fundamental spirit right. You know, there's fundamental human right. But you as a believer, your spirit is your fundamental spirit right to be taught in church what will impact your daily life. If you are not getting it, excuse the pastor. And let the pastor prove to you that he's teaching you what should impact your daily life. Not daily life as in the side of the bed you come down from when you wake up. No. I'm talking about spiritually. The side of the bed you come down from can't determine, it has nothing to contribute to whether you are transformed to the image of Christ or not. So we're talking spiritually now. It's your fundamental spirit right. Ask for it if you're not getting it. And if you're not getting it, not because it's not being given, but because you allow it to sleep, you're allowing the devil to steal it from you, just plug that loophole so that you can start having the benefits that God intends for you. What led us into all that? The prayer was that the will of God may become the reality, the living day-to-day experience of the believers. Enough is, I've heard it said before that God answers prayers. It should be, I asked God to do this and he's done it, experientially. It should be, now I can't believe this is me. You know, 5 years ago, I wouldn't take that from anybody. But look at it, it just rubbed it in my face and I'm like, Praise the Lord. God bless you, darling heart. That's what we're talking about. To further press home this, the understanding of this prayer the Apostle Paul prayed, let's look at 1 Peter 2. 1 Peter 2, 13 to 15. I'll read it quickly. Don't forget we're talking about the will of God, right? He says, no, sorry, I'm in 2 Peter. Spirit, boy, please go back. 1 Peter. Great. 1 Peter 2, 13. Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man for the Lord's sake. He's talking about law of the land here. Okay? Whether it be to the king as supreme or unto governors, as unto them that are sent by him, that is God, for the punishment of evildoers and for the praise of them that do well. The duty of government is to terrorize evildoers. The law of the land that will be compliant to what the God, what God calls the law, appropriate law, is the one that punishes evildoers and commends those and rewards those who have been good. Once it's otherwise, that is not the one God says you go and be subject to. Like, don't pray before you eat your food. I'm not saying it's the law of any land, but of course that can be right. Because the food is sanctified when we, by what? By the word of God and prayer. Let's move on. Verse 15. For so is the what? So is the what? So is the what? Will of God. See that? That with well-doing he may put to silence the ignorance of foolish men. Now, for practical purposes, you know, we should say the word of God is the will of God. But if I say, okay, what is in the word of God is his will. If we can't find any, this is one. Because God himself said it. This is my will. That with doing good, you will be able to silence the foolishness of evil people. What does that mean? Someone please help me. What does it mean? Expose them, Reverend?
Well, you prove to them that it can be done.
Hallelujah.
Because that was what Noah did.
Hallelujah.
And Noah proved to the world that even as evil as he was in his day,
glory,
man
will
still be righteous.
Hallelujah.
Praise the Lord.
It can be better. Let's see the grace and go. Hallelujah. I'm excited. That's just the truth. That is the will of God. See, whether you like it or not, if you are born again and you are true to it, the world will go after you and say you are evil. They did it to Jesus. So if you are Jesus' follower, they're going to do it to you. Whether you look for their trouble or not, God is saying, do you know what my will is? Whenever they say that, let it be so that they will never have proof. They can only say there will never be evidence. Why? Because you will always keep doing the right thing. This is the will of God. So Apostle Paul was praying for the believers at Colossae, by extension, us also. By extension, we should be praying one for another. We pray for you in this church. We should pray for one another that the will of God will become our reality. Take one more example. Hallelujah. One more example. 1 Thessalonians 4. 1 Thessalonians 4. 3 to 4. I'll read it quickly. For this is the will of God. Are we forced to get there? Are we there? I know you don't have your Bible, so I'm not waiting for you. Hallelujah. 1 Thessalonians 4. For the benefit of those who don't have their Bibles, I read. Of course, I will read anyway. Glory to God. For this is the will of God. See? We know the word of God is the will of God, but here specifically, God is saying, if you don't know any other will, okay, this is an example. For this is the will of God, even your sanctification, that you should abstain from fornication. But I thought, grace. Help me. I thought grace. There's grace now, so that nobody has to. Body is not. It's not firewood. Don't mind me. I'm just kidding. Glory to God. That everyone, that is verse 4, that every one of you should know how to possess his vessel in sanctification and honor. Now, this is not somebody said. This is God himself said, this is my will. That prayer that the Apostle Paul prayed was to the end that things like this will become the reality of the believer. We know how much we try to run away from things like this in today's churches. If we run away from them, it's a chain reaction. Number one, believers won't know that it's the will of God. So when people say, "Oh, all this is not possible," we tend to agree with them. Why? Because we don't know it's the will of God. That is one. Two, you see, it's one thing to know the will of God. Thereafter comes the battle of, okay, how do I walk in this will? And people will start struggling. You know why that struggle is always long and tedious in some cases? Nobody is doing what the Apostle Paul is doing, as you can see in Colossians 1, verse 8 to 11. Praying daily. Go to a church today, open your Bibles to 1 Thessalonians 4, pick a prayer point from verses 3 to 4. People will get offended. I'm not saying discotheque now. In the church, people will get offended and they tell you why you judge. Who is shut up? Okay, keep just shut up your mouth. So if nothing else, people who want to learn can learn. There is a physics to how spiritual things work. Please permit me. Hallelujah. There is an architecture to it. There is engineering inside it. If you look at it closely, it takes accounting to balance it also. There must always be a balance. There is a way. If we have not found out how it works, let's give ourselves prayer point. And let's go and fast and pray to find out how this thing works. Not that we just say it is not possible. Why was it possible in the early church? What we are finding out right now. Somebody prayed. Someone please join me and say, I will pray.
I will pray.
So we can see the reason why is this same Apostle Paul that said, pray without ceasing. Can you now understand? It doesn't work any other way. Preaching and teaching alone will not cut it. There is a place of prayer, supernatural help, supply of more grace. If supply of more grace is not in the equation, the Bible will not say, for he gives more grace. Prayer does it, folks. Yeah? So whatever we've tried before that has not worked out, let's add prayer to the equation. See, if it's a quadratic equation, there must be four parts to it. Are we together? If they are not four, it won't work. It's not quadratic. What we are looking for, and those other variables, A, B, C, they must be there. If one is missing, it won't work. But by the time we add the missing one to it, brush on what happens? See? Set it up. Solved. So this is one variable we are adding tonight by the special grace of God. Prayer. That the will of God becomes reality in the lives of the believer. I'm pleading with us. Please. I know we love ourselves. And Jesus Christ knows that we love ourselves. Because he said, love your neighbor as yourself. Even though he went a step further after that in the new covenant. Love your neighbor as I have loved you. I know you love yourself. So pray this for yourself. Not only this one, every other thing that has to do with God's will. Then make it a habit to pray for every believer you know every day. Somebody says, oh, how many believers do I even know? Even if I just one, pray for them. And then pray for the unbeliever to every day that you know that they be saved. It doesn't add too much burden to our prayer time. Pray out of a genuine desire from the heart. And then we see things change as they should around us. God will help us in the name of the Lord Jesus, he will. Right after that, in verse 11, do we get the picture of verse 9? Being filled with the knowledge of his will. It's not just mental knowledge. No, cram the Bible. That's not. The end result is the will of God, which is the word of God becoming reality in our lives. Right after that, look at what the Apostle Paul said. What proof will you have to show if the will of God is becoming reality in your life? It's in verse 10. That you may walk worthy of the Lord. In other words, walk to God's commendation. God saying, Omodada. Wadada. Can God say that? You don't know that each time you as a child, you honor your father and your mother. You don't know that's what God is saying. That's what God is saying. It's in his word. Honor your father and your mother. That you just, each time you obey God, that's exactly what is coming from the heart of God towards blessings. Hallelujah. That you may walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing. Being fruitful in every evil work. Right? No, Pastor, I disagree. Maybe Apostle Paul made a mistake. It should be evil work because there is grace. See? Oh, if there is no evil work, what will grace be for then? You know, I'm just kidding. Hallelujah. We keep on seeing the fallacy of the other side, that heretic part of teaching about grace. Being fruitful in every good work and increasing the knowledge of God. That is the proof. That is the proof that the will of God is your reality. Hallelujah. Amen. That is part of what, and this thing is not anything, it's not a biggie. Because the Epaphras saw it in the Colossian believers. It's you understand? It's as simple as, you know. Not any big thing that cannot be attained. It's not. Bible says that the commandments of God are not grievous. The will of God is not grievous. It's as simple as children obey your father and mother. I don't know how simple can that be. As simple as that. Commandments of God are not grievous. No. And then the 11th verse, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. Unto all patience and long suffering with joyfulness. We're going to end here tonight.